Welcome to Re'eh Yisrael, which means in English, Behold, O Israel, the Bible-teaching television ministry of Congregation Shema Yisrael. Shema Yisrael is a Messianic Jewish congregation in Rochester, New York. Be sure to get out your Bible and a notebook and follow along with this week's lesson from the Scriptures. Shalom. Thank you for watching this video. I'm taking a moment to share some important information about Congregation Shema Yisrael. We are following the leading of the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit, to purchase a new facility for our congregation in the heart of the Jewish community of Rochester, New York. We've experienced several miraculous confirmations that this purchase is God's plan to make us more effective in our outreach to the Jewish community here. Our previous facility has been sold, and we are meeting in rented quarters until we close on the new facility at the end of 2020. Through the generous donations of our regular attenders, we've raised a significant part of the funds that will be needed to close, but we also need your help. If you've been blessed by our videos, please pray for us and ask the Lord, what do you want to do through me to accomplish your will for Congregation Shema Yisrael? If you pray this prayer and do what God leads you to do in faith, we will succeed in purchasing this facility and become much more effective in reaching the Jewish people of Rochester with the life-saving good news of Messiah Yeshua. To participate, please visit shematime.org, that's shematime.org, where you can learn more about this amazing move of God and where you can support us by clicking the donate button. Thank you, and may the Lord richly bless you as you watch this video. I found, as I shared a couple of weeks ago, there's a tremendous difference between talking to faces, even if they have masks on, and talking to my laptop computer. It makes a tremendous difference in how I'm able to share with you, how I'm able to speak. But I also noticed something else today that was significant in making a difference in the ability to bring the word. When I was, for the past 8 weeks or so, was speaking into my laptop computer to record things, I would just do it, and I wouldn't worship for a half hour beforehand. And so I want to thank the worship team, because I realized that that's a big part of getting under the anointing, is being here and being able to worship together and have that filling of the Spirit. So thank you, worship team. So we've got Rabbi Irving with us here today, and here's a little way that Rabbi Irving prevailed in a difficult situation. So Arnold and Howard were brothers who had lived and worked in Rochester all their lives. Unfortunately, nothing good could be said about them. They ran a crooked business, they womanized, they lied, they cheated the poor, but they were also very, very wealthy. When Arnold died, Howard went to Rabbi Irving and said, I will donate to the temple $100,000 if you will say at the funeral that my brother Irving was a mensch. Everybody know what a mensch is? A good person. It's Yiddish for a good person. Rabbi Irving thought long and hard, prayed about it, and eventually agreed. At the funeral, Rabbi Irving told everyone present of Arnold's wrongdoings and what a terrible person he was. He then closed with this sentence, but compared to his brother Howard, he was a real mensch. So as Elizabeth shared a little bit, we are hoping to have significantly more in attendance here next Shabbat, and we will keep you updated on that. So I'm sure I'm speaking for everyone who's watching and listening to say that we are all tired of being quarantined. We're all struggling with it, and we're hoping it is ending because we're into phase 3 here in New York. But even when we get to phase four and beyond, we may see a long period of social distancing and wearing face coverings. And then I'm concerned that there's a possibility that with the mass demonstrations that happened and violated all the rules of the social distancing, we may see a second wave. I don't want to speak that. I want to pray against it, but that's also possible. We won't know that until a few weeks pass, because it takes that much time for the virus to become visible. So right now, we are all dealing with loneliness, and we may have to continue to deal with it for some time. And it's been hard for me, but I have my wonderful wife, Diane, and praise God, we have each other. My heart goes out to those of you who live alone, because it's got to be so much harder if you're living alone than if you have at least one other person to share this with. So why do we struggle with loneliness? It's basically because when we're alone, we're not experiencing love coming from other people. And love is vitally important for our mental, emotional, physical, and spiritual health. God created us to flourish in an atmosphere of love from other people. That's why he created us to be raised by families. And he put a powerful love in parents for their children, and usually a love for each other in siblings. Now, normally we get that assurance of being loved from our friends and family, but for the past 3 months, we haven't been able to be with them in person. And a very significant book in my life, and I think many of you have read this, is called The Five Love Languages. And the five love languages are five ways people give and receive love. The five ways that people show their love for each other. And just going to list them here. It's through words, verbally. It's through serving each other. It's through giving of our time just to be with each other. It's through gifts. And it's through touch. So what the book explains is that each person has a primary and a secondary love language, which are the ways they are most receptive to love. And the book actually has an exercise in it, a test you can take, that can help you identify what your love language is. But it's important to understand that if you have a primary and a secondary, everybody still receives love in the other three ways also. And one of those love languages, the one I mentioned last, is touch. And for those living alone, it has been completely absent for 3 months. For those of us who have a spouse or children in the house, at least we have someone, but certainly not as much. I thank God for Diane and I that we can hug each other, because that's an important way in which we experience love. But I miss the hugs of the rest of you. And even just handshakes and fist bumps and high fives. And even though my primary love language is not touch, I still miss receiving love through the touch of others. So during this quarantine, all of us have been experiencing a lack of love from other people. We're all love starved. And we've learned that there are some significant effects of not experiencing love. We've been studying the spiritual roots of disease and other dysfunctions for several years, and we've found out that scientists have been able to measure brain activity in the last, about 10 or 15 years, and they can correlate it with the thoughts that people are thinking. And what they found is that when you think peaceful, thankful thoughts, your brain activity measures differently from when you're thinking angry or fearful thoughts. And scientists have also determined that our brains trigger secretions of different substances, hormones, chemicals, depending on what you're thinking. So we now know that thoughts, feelings, attitudes can be separated into two broad categories. Thoughts that cause the brain to trigger secretions that are good for our health. And when I say healthier, I'm talking about physical,
mental, emotional, relational, and spiritual health, and our brains can trigger toxic thoughts that are harmful to health in all of those areas. And these are defiling thoughts. So what are some of the thoughts that produce health? Well, you probably guessed them already. Peace, security, love, being loved, gratefulness, joyfulness, experiencing kindness, humble thoughts. What are some of the toxic, defiling thoughts that produce harmful effects? Well, first one is fearful thoughts. And it's been identified that in the English language, there are 4,000 different kinds of fear. There's a different word, 4,000 different words for different kinds of fears. Stress, anxiety, worry, tension, nervousness. And then there are bitter thoughts, unforgiveness, resentment, anger, hatred. And then there's a whole bunch of others. Envy, jealousy, rejection, lust, greed, self-hatred, depression, hopelessness, suicidal thoughts, pride, idolatry, rebellion. All of these are toxic. And medical research has concluded that 80% of all incurable physical, mental, and emotional diseases are caused by toxic thinking. And just to give you a couple examples, which you're probably aware of because you probably know somebody who has high blood pressure, and the doctors are always saying, you have to be less stressed. So stress is a form of fear, and stress causes high blood pressure. And we also know that people who get angry a lot, have outbursts of anger or build up the anger in them, they have heart problems. So we see this, and it's amazing that the Bible, written thousands of years ago, concurs with these findings. So if we could have the first slide here, Proverbs chapter 14 and verse 30 says, a tranquil mind gives health to the body, but envy rots the bones. So we call these toxic ways of thinking the spiritual roots of disease. And a couple of years ago, I had this amazing revelation. It kind of unified all that I had been studying and brought together all of this, the understanding and the ideas. And I realized that most of these spiritual roots that I mentioned here, what I called them out before, you know, the bitterness and the fear and the hatred and the envy, all those things, most of them grow from one single deeper spiritual root. And that is a lack of knowing that we are loved. Let me give an example. Worry. Worry is one of those roots. And why do people worry? It's because they don't believe that they're loved by someone who will take care of them. So they're afraid for the future. And how about bitterness? Well, something terrible happened that hurt me. So God, who is supposed to love me, must not love me. So I'm bitter toward God. They all come down to underneath that there's this lack of knowing we are loved. And researchers have found that love can actually be measured. The brain activity is changed when you experience love. There's a peacefulness and a security that you feel. Your nervous system responds positively. Your body chemistry works more efficiently. Here's a big one that impacts us right now. Your immune system actually strengthens, making you less prone to contagious diseases. So you can see how the social distancing and the quarantine could have like a positive effect that we're avoiding contagion, but what about the fact that we're feeling less love, so now our immune system becomes weaker? Could be. The hormones and chemicals that make your body function well and make you feel good are released when you are in when you know that you're being loved. So all this should not come as a surprise, because it's common knowledge about infants that if they're not held, if they're born and they're in an orphanage, if there's no one to hold them and love them, they usually don't develop normally. They grow up troubled. And this even holds with pets. And we had a very clear example of this several years ago. We had a cat, and I've got a picture of him up here. His name was Chester. There's Chester. Chester was a stray. We found him, and I think Elizabeth actually found him, right, on the road, and took him in, and he was a stray, and we loved him, and he was wonderful, wonderful cat. And yet, no matter how much we loved him, he was always fearful. If there was a noise in the house, boom, he would go hide. If somebody came in, knocked on the door, he would hide. He would take off. And he always was fearful. And then we had another cat. The next slide there. There's Everest. Everest was born in our bedroom closet from his mother, whom we owned. We had him all the days of his life. He was loved from the moment he came out. And he was so laid back. You know, a firecracker could go off and he would look up and go, oh, what's that? He just had this confidence about himself. Even when he did something wrong, you know, and we would have to scold him or punish him in some way, immediately he would be back and saying, oh, you love me, don't you? Everybody loves me. If strangers came into the house, he would immediately go up to him because he just knew that everybody was going to love him. And it was so dramatic between these two cats. So why does love have such a positive effect on us? Well, I think it's pretty simple. God created us having this need for love. That's why he put a great love in parents for their children. Now think about, when we talk about a great love, we talk about a mother's love or a father's love for their children. So the unifying revelation was that I realized if you truly believed you are loved, and are actually experiencing love, most of these problem-causing spiritual roots just go away. They just disappear. And as believers, we are used to receiving love touches in our times of fellowship, hugs, prayer with the laying on of hands. But because of the quarantine, we're experiencing a drought, a famine of love. And that's why being quarantined, I believe, is so difficult for us. So I want to spend the rest of the time here on helping us to get through this drought. God's great plan for us is to bring us back into fellowship with him through the Messiah. In 1 John chapter 1 and verse 3, we read this. What we have seen and heard, we are proclaiming to you so that you too may have fellowship with us. Who's the us here? Yeshua and the Father. Our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Yeshua the Messiah. So God is saying that he wants us to have fellowship with Messiah. And when you experience fellowship with someone, you are affected by their personality, by how they treat you. Think about this. Have you ever spent time with a bitter person? What happens? You pick it up. It's contagious. It's contagious. So also with an angry person, you pick it up. So when you're with someone who's optimistic or encouraging, it helps you. So how are you affected by being in fellowship with God? Well, 1 John chapter 4 and verse 8 says these very powerful three little words. God is love. His very nature is love. So when you come into fellowship with him, you experience being in the presence of love. And God created you to be experiencing his love, basking in it. He created you to function optimally as a human being in fellowship with him in an atmosphere of his love. So what's it like to be in the presence of love? I'm sure many who are hearing this have experienced being in the presence of someone who really loved you. If you had a parent or a sibling or a friend or a spouse or a child who really loved you and whom you really loved, you know what it was. It was a wonderful, uplifting experience to be with them. It was strengthening. It was encouraging. When you're with them, you feel loved. You feel accepted. You feel affirmed. You feel encouraged. It gives you a boost to be with them. You're better able to face the struggles of life, because you've been in the presence of someone who loves you. When you're down, they encourage you. When you don't think you can go on, they strengthen you. When you're happy, they rejoice with you. They always see the best in you. They always hope for your success. They always trust you. They're always kind to you. They don't get angry with you easily. They're always polite to you. They don't hold your mistakes against you. They don't gloat when you fail. Did anybody recognize that I just paraphrased the scripture? That was 1 Corinthians 13, the love chapter. That's what love is. If you've never experienced a loving relationship like this, you're not alone. Many people have never been loved in such a way. They're like Chester, never experienced that love as a child or even as an adult. But if that's you, don't be too discouraged, because even if a person loves you very much, people are still people. They're human. And they have their own baggage, their own issues, their own shortcomings. And sometimes when you're in need of encouragement, that person might be really struggling with something and they can't encourage you. So I had an example of this in my mother. She loved me very much, but she was a chronic worrier. And all through my childhood and teenage years, I suffered from terrible allergies. I had to go for tests, and then I had to go for shots for years. Finally, I graduated high school and I went away to college. You know what happened? All the allergies went away. All the allergies went away. Why? Because I wasn't exposed to that worry all the time. Because my mom was not perfect. Her love for me was not perfect. She did love me. I know she loved me. And her love for me was very important in my life, in my development. But it also had a downside. And I'm human. I know there have been times I failed to show my children love, my wife love, some of you love. And some of you have been loved for a while by a romantic interest who later rejected you. And now you're more love-starved than before. The truth is, and this is another one of those flash revelations, it's impossible to find a person who loves you so much that they will always behave toward you in a loving way. When they do, it helps tremendously, but no one is perfect. So because God created us to function in an atmosphere of love, and we don't experience it all the time, especially while we're in quarantine, most of us go through life love-starved, and we don't even know it. We just think it's normal. Many of us are love-starved right now because of the quarantine. And there's a well-known phrase that uncovers a problem, that people search for love in all the wrong places. Some turn to porn or prostitution or promiscuity, someone to love them. Others turn to drugs or alcohols to get rid of the pain of not feeling loved. Actually, that was a big snare for me when I was in college. I didn't have any girlfriends and just didn't feel loved. And so I would just drink. And it was all due to loneliness. And, you know, some people really struggle with getting delivered from alcohol. As soon as I met Diane, it just disappeared. Why? Because I felt loved. It was just went away. Some go to doctors and complain of depression. And doctors medicate them to cope with their depression. So here's that new insight. Being love-starved is the root cause of many of those spiritual, emotional, mental, and physical problems. And this is a universal problem of all human beings, not just our culture, but many cultures. And it has become worse, really, all around the world, because the whole world is in quarantine right now. So, what can you do to satisfy your need to be loved in the midst of this quarantine? There's an incredibly simple solution to this universal problem. And it's an integral part of God's plan for each of us. In praying to the Father who is love, who is the source of all love, Yeshua says about his followers in John 17, 23, Father, you have loved them just as you have loved me. Now just let that sink in a little bit. God loves each of you who is a follower of Yeshua. How? As he loves Yeshua. How does God love Yeshua? Well, he's his only begotten son, and he is the most lovable of all his creations. So I think he might love him a lot. What do you think? Yes. And what is God's love like? What is it like? God loves Yeshua with the greatest love there could ever be, because God is love. He's the source of love. His love is infinite. It's perfect. It meets all our needs for love. God's love is the limitless source of love for all of the love-starved people in the world. It's the solution to the universal problem of humanity and is needed for us to get through this quarantine, however long it lasts. But here's a sad truth that I know because I've done a lot of counseling with people. The truth is that most believers know the Bible says God loves them, but few have actually experienced his love in their hearts, in their emotions, and fewer still live their daily lives feeling like they are loved by him. I can personally testify to the power of God's love. I have experienced it many times, but there are still times when I'm not feeling it. I'm not feeling it in my emotions and my heart. There are times when I'm not living my life as if I'm loved by God. And I think if you're honest with yourself, the rest of you can agree with that. So the Lord wants you to receive God's love, to receive his love today. And this is such an important distinction. He doesn't want you to know about his love, but to know his love. He wants you to experience it. Either here today or over this coming week, because you need a big dose of his love. We all do. So I can't make that happen. Only he can. So let's just take a minute right now and pray in agreement. Is everybody in agreement that you'd like to experience God's love? So Father, we read these scriptures and they're mind-boggling. You are love and you love each of us the way you love Yeshua. And Lord, we believe that it's your will. It's your great desire that each of us would know your love, not just about it so we can tell someone else, oh, God loves you, but so that we experience it deep in our hearts. We feel that joy of knowing that we are loved by you. And so I pray, Father, in faith that as we look at what the rest of you gave me here to share, that we, everyone who's hearing this, will actually experience your love. Some of us have experienced it before. They'll experience it again. Some of us for the first time. So let's dig in to what the Bible says about God's love to just grasp it a little more. First of all, God did not create love. Did you know that? He is love. He is love. His love is his very nature. 1 John chapter 4 and verse 9 says this: here is how God showed his love among us. God sent his only son into the world so that through him we might have life. Now, what he's saying here is that Yeshua's life and death is the greatest demonstration there has ever been of anyone's love, but it's the demonstration of God's love. Verse 10, here is what love is. Not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son to be the kapora, the atonement for our sins. So because of sin, we humans have been separated from God ever since the Garden of Eden. But God made a way for us to be reconnected, to have a loving relationship with him by coming to earth as a human being, Yeshua, and sacrificing his life to make atonement for us. Yeshua also gave us the clearest description and demonstration of God's love. In John 15, verse 13, he says this: no one has greater love than a person who lays down his life for his friends. So God's love was demonstrated by Yeshua's self-sacrificing action. In the Tanakh, God speaks much of love. We just recited it here. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. But in the Tanakh, we don't find a demonstration of his love like this. We see him caring for people, but we don't see this sacrifice. It wasn't until Yeshua's death that he demonstrated his love by enduring unbelievable physical, spiritual, mental, and emotional pain to make atonement for you and I. But many believers don't think God loved them very much. He loves everybody else, but not them. In 1 John chapter 4, again in verse 16, we read this: also, we have come to know and trust the love that God has for us. God is love, and those who remain in this love remain united with or abide in God, and God remains united with or abides in them. So this is what many translations talk about being in Messiah, or Messiah or God in you. To abide in God means to be in his love, surrounded by his love. Not like I'm in love with someone, but in his love, like being surrounded with love, his love. Like coming to a place, knocking on the door, and somebody opens the door, and everybody in there loves you, and they're like, oh, we're so glad you're here. Welcome, have a hug, you know, that's what it's like. So I had this vision, I don't know if you call it a vision or a revelation, of God's love. If we can see the next slide there. Not there? Oh my gosh, where is it? Well, I guess it's not there. Huh, I know I put it in. Back up again. You didn't see a picture in there of a girl. Well, I'm sorry. Okay, I'll have to describe it. It's going to be hard to describe. There are these giant plastic balls that are made. They're tough plastic, and they have like a latch in them. So we're talking about like 10 feet high diameter. And you can actually get inside those things. And they pump it up with air, and then you can walk on water. Because it's you know, it's buoyant, and it holds the air, and you can walk around in it. So the image that I had is that being in the Lord, in his love, is like being inside this love bubble, okay? This big ball that extends all around you that is his love. And wherever you go, it's like you're walking in this thing on water, and wherever you go, it rolls with you. So you take it with you wherever you go. It precedes you because it's bigger than you. It follows you. It's above you. So that kind of symbolizes that his love is being showered down on you. It's below you to protect you from Satan. It's on your right and your left to protect you from anybody who would attack you. It's his love in this giant bubble that is protecting you. And that's what it's like to be in God's love. Like this verse just said, to be united with or abide in God's love. Verse 17, if you can find the place there where John, 1 John 4:17, after I made you jump all over the place. Here is how love has been brought to maturity with us. As the Messiah is, so are we in this world. This gives us confidence for the day of judgment. When God's love is mature in you, you will be as the Messiah is in the world. You are his way of loving people, his heart, his ears, his hands, his arms. Verse 18, there is no fear in love. On the contrary, love that has achieved its goal gets rid of fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The person who keeps fearing has not been brought to maturity in regard to love. So God's love casts out fear. This doesn't mean that you can't ever be afraid. It means that God's love will overcome chronic fear. That's the antidote for it. Why? Because when you are mature in your regard to love, or love has been perfected in you, you will be so confident that God loves you that you will not be shaken by fear. He's taking care of you. He is not going to let anything happen. And even if he does, he's going to help you get through it. So it's like being in that love bubble all the time. But there's a problem that some people have with their love bubble. Sometimes the hardships of life puncture the love bubble, and the love flows out. Betrayals, people's broken promises, other things that we experience. And the ball collapses. It's no longer a sphere. It's like a blanket hanging over to you. And those holes need to be repaired. And the only thing that can repair them is the healing power of God's love. And then the ball needs to be reinflated again with God's love. So there's an obstacle, a big obstacle, to receiving God's love. And this may apply to some of you who are listening. If people in your life who were ordained by God, who were put in your life by God to show you love during your formative years, people like parents and siblings and aunts and uncles, cousins, and then a little bit further on, teachers, coaches, even neighbors, instead of loving you, they abused you, used you, manipulated you, hated you, demeaned you, humiliated you, bullied you, deceived you, betrayed you, attacked you, and hurt you, you will think that that's what people who love you will do to you. So you'll be afraid to let anybody love you or trust that God really loves you, because you've associated in your life, those who love you get associated with pain. And your heart may be wounded and have scars and places where you think it's too hard for God's love to penetrate. So we're going to pray later for those scars. Here's another obstacle to receiving God's love. Many people can accept that God loves people, but not themselves. But God does not show favorites. He loves you as much as he loves any of his other children. And as godly parents, those of you who are parents, you know you love all your children with all your heart, whether they obey you or not, or whether they meet your expectations or not, or whether they have great characters. You love them because they're your children. And God sees you as his child. So he loves you as his child. He saw you as his child even when you were in rebellion. And just like a human parent may love a rebellious child, but they can't have a loving relationship with that child until that child stops rebelling. So God could not have a loving relationship with you until you submitted to him as Lord. That certainly was the case in my life. But now he's able to show his love for you, and you are able to show your love for him by obeying him. John 17, verse 23, Yeshua again speaking. I, Yeshua, in them, in my disciples, and you, God, in me, that they may be perfected in unity, so that the world may know that you sent me and have loved them as you loved me. Again, God loves you as he loves the Messiah. Now, there's another barrier to receiving God's love. It's a spirit. It's a principality, actually, and it's called unloving. And so unloving works in the spirit world, and it makes you unable to receive or give love, and or give love. And this spirit's power must be broken, and it must be removed in your life for you to be able to receive the fullness of God's love. And we're going to pray for that later. So how can you receive God's love? Well, God doesn't love directly with the love language of touch. That's pretty clear. He uses other people to pour out his love on you with touch. And that's what we're missing in this quarantine. But God does pour out his love with the other four love languages. And it's good to understand them so you can understand when he's doing something. This is one of his love languages, and you can receive it. So let's just look at the other four here. Number one, God wants to pour his love out on you through the love language of time. He will always be available to spend time with you. But just like in a human relationship, you must take the time to spend with him. Worship, prayer, study of his word is how you make that time. And we are so blessed in our day and age to be able to have worship music anytime. I mean, if you go back to Yeshua's time, the only way you could have worship is you had to sing it yourself, or you know, somebody else had to be there. But we've got MP3 players and we've got it online. It's worship music is everywhere. Prayer is another way we spend time. But I'm talking about here a specific kind of prayer, not intercession, not supplication, but listening to hear the Lord. His word. Reading his word and receiving it as if he's writing it directly to you, a love letter to you. The second way God wants to pour out his love is through the love language of gifts. He has given you so many gifts. Just think about it. Forgiveness, eternal life, the Holy Spirit, peace. What are they? They're all the gifts of God. To experience God's love, you need to do what Psalm 136 does. It remembers all the gifts. It goes through and recites. Praise the Lord, for his mercy endures forever. For this, he did this, he did this. All the things that he did for Israel. So recalling and thanking God for all the great things he has done for you and given you is how you experience the gift of, how you experience God's love through his gifts. Number three, God wants to pour out his love on you through the love language of service, serving you. Well, how is God going to serve me? Well, he did it in the past. Matthew chapter 20 and verse 28 says, "For the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many." He didn't just give you the gifts of forgiveness, salvation, and eternal life. He served you by paying the terrible price of suffering for those gifts. And then in John 16, verse 13, he says, "However, when the Spirit of truth," that's the Holy Spirit, "comes, he will guide you into all truth. For he will not speak on his own initiative, but will only say what he hears. He will also announce to you the events of the future." So I just realized this today, that the Lord serves you today and me as the Holy Spirit, revealing truth, giving us wisdom, giving counsel. Here's another way he's serving us right now. In Hebrews chapter 7, verse 25, it says, "He is alive forever and thus forever able to intercede on their behalf." He is in the throne room right now interceding for you. The fourth love language. God wants to pour his love out on you through the love language of words. Words. This, I believe, is the most powerful way of experiencing God's love, is to be able to hear him say, "I love you." It's hard to do. It's hard to believe you're really hearing him. When I first tried to hear God's voice, I expected, oh, he's going to give me some great revelation or some insight into scripture. And for years, literally, every time I tried to hear the Lord's voice, I would hear him say, "I love you." And I would say, "Oh, Lord, tell me something more." And he would just say, "I love you. That's what you need to hear. That's what you need to hear until you really begin to receive it. I love you." I thought it was my own imagination, but I finally accepted it was him. And I'm not saying I was hearing audible voices, just in my mind. I would say, "Lord, speak to me." And I would get this thought, "I love you. Is that you, Lord? I love you. Receive it. Receive it. I love you." In the Bible, those who doubt you can hear God's voice, how many people in the Bible heard God's voice? A whole lot. Here's how you hear it. Jeremiah chapter 29 and verse 13. "When you seek me, you will find me, provided you seek for me wholeheartedly. And I will let you find me, says Adonai." Wholeheartedly. What does that mean? That means all your heart, your whole heart. And he will let you find him. So what does this mean? Well, practically it means taking some private time, shutting off the many distractions that tempt us. TV, internet, smartphones, video games, even friends. And the many demanding distractions that pull on us. Work, homework, worry, bitterness, pride. Shutting off all of those things and meditating on his word, especially his promises to love you. It means praying to God to experience his love. I found worship music really helps. And my experience is this is so important. Whenever I really want to connect with God's love, he's always available there for me. That's the time thing. He always has the time for me. He never is rushed. He's never got something else that he's doing. It's always me. It's always me making the time to be in his presence. His love is my source of strength, my reason for living, and as I've learned over the past few years, the source of health for my spirit, my mind, my emotions, and my body. I want to just end with this prayer that Paul prayed in Ephesians chapter 3, which is really Paul's message on this whole subject. And please receive this, each of you. Chapter 3, verse 16. This is Paul praying. "I pray that from the treasures of his glory, he will empower you with inner strength by his Spirit, so that Messiah may live in your hearts through your trusting. Also, I pray that you will be rooted and founded in love." Rooted is the Greek word rizo. We get the word rizone from this. It's a part of a plant's roots, that you'll be rooted in love. And founded is a little bit strange word, but it means that God's love will be the foundation of your life. You will be planted on the foundation of God's love. Verse 18, so that you, with all God's people, will be given the strength, it takes strength, to grasp the breadth, the length, the height, and the depth of the Messiah's love. You're to be rooted, have your foundation in God's love. And he also describes it as being huge, huge, limitless. 19, yes, to know it. Not know about it, but know it. Even though it is beyond all knowing, meaning you can't know all of it, so that you will be filled with all the fullness of God. To know it. Paul knew that no matter how much he came to know God's love, there would always be more of it to experience. And that's been my experience. I know of his love to some level, and then more is revealed to me. I just had one. I was putting up the awning on our patio this week, and I tripped over something and started to fall. It was fall from a height of about this far and onto a concrete, and then off the concrete onto the ground, and I'm rolling along, and it's like an angel is just kind of setting me down gently on the ground. It was amazing. Not even a scar, not even a bruise. And I just got up and I went, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Another, I guess that would be the language of serving. He served me by keeping me from being injured. So what does knowing God's love for you do for you according to this? It fills you with all the fullness of God. And here's the last verse here. This connection is what Yeshua spoke about when he said in John 15, verse 5, I am the vine and you are the branches. Those who stay united with me and I with them are the ones who bear much fruit, because apart from me, you can't do a thing. So I've been practiced this being connected to the vine for a long time, but I at some point began to understand that this connection is the source of my strength and the ability to bear fruit for his kingdom. I've known that. And I do it by studying, reading his word, worship, fellowship, prayer. But recently I've come to understand how that connection actually works. And here's what I've seen, and this is something that is just so real to me. It's when I experience his love flowing into me, that's when the sap of the vine is flowing into me. That's it. You know, I can try to be in his presence and be reading his word and all this, but unless I'm actually experiencing his love flowing into me, it's not like I'm hooked to the vine, because the vine is love. And I have to say, the Holy Spirit has chastised me over and over. You haven't made time for being in my presence for a couple of days. And he's trained me to get there daily. I still mess up. And you know what? When I come in his presence, he doesn't rebuke me and say, I'm sorry, you missed 3 days. I'm not going to talk to you today. He says, oh, I'm so glad. I'm so glad that you finally realized that you need to come into my presence. How do you do it daily? Get alone. Get quiet. Read and meditate on his word. Ask him to speak through it. Especially meditate on where his promises are. Sing worship songs. I sing along to recorded ones. The more you do, you will feel his love. But let me just give a warning. You can sing worship songs all day and never really connect with his love. You can pray all day and never really connect with his love. It helps, but you can never really connect. You have to want it with all your heart. That's what the verse in Jeremiah says. When you seek me with all your heart, you will find me. So I would like to just take a moment and offer an opportunity for all of you who are hearing this, whether here or online in your homes or wherever you are, to try to connect right now. I'm going to pray, and then we're going to have a little instrumental music and just have a little quiet time where you can try to connect with the Lord. And I believe you're going to do it. So let me pray first. Father, I pray that you help each person, first of all, to see how much he or she needs to be loved, needs to know that they are loved. And I also pray, Lord, that you'd show us that we really can't depend on other people to be our source of love. It's great when we have them, but they're all going to be human at times. And we repent of any bitterness to those who should have loved us but didn't. We repent of all expectations that others would love us. Lord, help us to believe that you love us as you love Yeshua. Help us believe that you want us to experience your love in a way that we can feel in our hearts. We repent, Lord, of any ways we've disobeyed you. We ask you to be the Lord of our lives. We commit ourselves to follow you. We repent of entertaining that unloving spirit by accepting or believing that we're not loved. We renounce that unloving spirit. Let's just say this together. I am loved by God. Can you say it with me? I am loved by God. And in the name of Yeshua, we command that unloving spirit to leave, go into its dark places, and trouble us no more. And God, give us discernment to keep it from returning. And let's say this together. I'll say it first. Lord, I believe what you say in your word. Lord, I believe what you say in your word, that you love me as you love Yeshua, that you love me as you love Yeshua. Lord, open the way for me to experience the fullness of your love. Show me how I can come into your presence. Give me the discipline to come daily. And now you can stop. I want you to take a moment, and Randy, would you come up to the keyboard? And as he prays, listen for his voice inside you. He wants you to hear him say, I love you. I love you, Mark. I love you, Elizabeth. I love you, Don. I love you. I love you. Every one of you here, every one of you out there, he wants you to hear you to hear him say that. So, Randy, go ahead. Thank you, Lord. Are you hearing him? Just listen. He's singing it to me, even to this melody. Thank you, Rand.
Stay tuned for a short closing message from Rabbi Jim Appel.
Shalom. I'm Messianic Rabbi Jim Appel, and I hope you enjoyed our TV program. It was produced for you by Congregation Shema Yisrael, a Messianic Jewish synagogue. Shema Yisrael is a congregation of Jewish and non-Jewish people who worship the God of Israel while maintaining our Jewish identity and lifestyle, and who believe that Yeshua, whose English name is Jesus, is Israel's promised Messiah. Shema Yisrael's purposes are to proclaim Yeshua as Messiah to Jewish and non-Jewish people and help them connect personally with the God of Israel through worship. We welcome you to join our mishpacha, or family, and connect with your Jewish roots. I'd love to meet you personally at one of our weekly Shabbat services or at one of our special events where people from all backgrounds are welcome. Shalom.
We hope you enjoyed today's teaching. Call our office to request a copy on videotape. If you would like more information about Messianic Judaism or Shema Yisrael, please call us at 585-288-0670 or visit our website at www.shemayisrael.org, where you can find a listing of upcoming special events. Please join us for our weekly Shabbat service. Saturday morning, complete children's program interpretation for the deaf is available. Please notify us in advance if it is needed. Congregation Shema Yisrael also sponsors Bengals and Blessings, a Messianic music and talk radio program with Ethel Chadwick. You can also hear Bengals and Blessings by going to our website, www.shemayisrael.org, or bengalsandblessings.com. Please join us for our Messianic Judaism class, Israeli dance class, Hebrew class, or youth group. Call the office for hours and locations. Tune in next week when Re'eh Yisrael will again bring you teachings from the Scriptures.